very much, Rose. Let me extend warm welcome to all the legal community who have come today, but also all of you from other places inside and outside the university. We're really thrilled that you could come to the law school, and we're really happy to be hosting this event. And as Rose said, the previous Constellations project, which is all credit to Rose and as well her brainchild, was to think about how disciplines can come together from disparate parts of the academic and political community to raise questions that are meaningful to how we all live in broader communities. And this particular constellation managed to constellate themselves quite independently of being invited to come today. So what we really want to emphasise is that constellations are also about conversation, and this is a really important question for scholars working between disciplines to work. It's about relationships, it's about working with others in order to address practices and problems and experience of how we live in time and place. And in relation to this particular project, which Julie is going to introduce in a moment, which is about thinking about how we live in Melbourne and acknowledging the traditional owners of the place we meet. It's about how Indigenous peoples in particular have taught us this as a profound lesson that's at the centre of our jurisprudential and political life, about how to work with others and to listen and learn in practice and in collaboration. So the core question that's at the heart of the Minutes of this project is about how is injustice as a practice something that is continued and lived in our community, even in the present day. And in law, sometimes these things are called wicked problems, things that don't have automatic or easy answers, and they require listening to others, and as I said, in particular in relation to Indigenous people, engaging with them to work through a whole range of different practices to address ways to think about what, clearly reform has not been necessarily the answer. Legal reform, legal practice, legal contest is not something that addresses the immediacy of structural injustice and how people live. It's not only that. So it's really important we hold this seminar today at the Melbourne Law School and as a project of collaboration, and that it's staged here because I think, as we'll talk about in a moment, law forms and creates and maintains the conditions by which this particular event that we can think through was experienced here in Victoria in particular times and places, and that it's held at Melbourne Law School, which as Mark might talk to later, a lot of the individuals involved in the 1881 inquiry were people trained at the Melbourne Law School who held legal office in the Melbourne community, and we have responsibilities here as an institution to acknowledge that as part of our history also. So I need to introduce the panel before we kind of talk about the project, and there's as you can see, an impressive and vast lineup, and some of the members of this panel of the project aren't even here today because they're scattered at far-flung places around the world, including at Sussex University, at Royal Holloway, and some are actually at home looking after their children as well. So we'll just introduce those who are here. So first of all, I'd like to some of you may already know all of these people. So Dr. Julie Evans, who's a senior lecturer in criminology. She's also an incredibly dear friend. That's the other thing I should say about these conversations and collaboration. This is a pleasure for me because I've managed to work with all these people in various sorts of places too. So Julie is a historian. She works with intersections of history and law and thinking about the experience of Indigenous peoples in imperial and pre-imperial contexts. And she's she's the lead researcher on the project. In her role in the Minutes of Evidence project is to address questions and notions of justice in settler states with a particular focus on understanding the complexity of how the past can lead to new ways of living together justly in the present and future. And next to Julie, we have Lilly Brown. Lilly belongs to the Gumbanja people of the mid-north coast of New South Wales. She grew up, she says, in the foothills of Perth, however, and she's travelled far and wide, including finishing her BA in History and Anthropology from UWA. She's been a Charlie Perkins Scholar. She's completed an MPhil in Politics, Development and Democratic Education at the University of Cambridge. And she has a specific role in this project to think about how you communicate through an event such and a creation of a collaborative project like this to in terms of education and community. And then, of course, we have Dr. Mark McMillan next to Lilly, who you should be familiar to all of you. I hardly even need to introduce you. Mark's like too busy to breathe at the moment, but he's come on.
We came on together with Black Hand.
I just want to talk about that and how that works in this particular course of collaboration later on. And then we have Nathan McMillan, who's also part of the Melbourne University community at Criminology. And her particular focus is to think about the national and the international and questions of justice and how we might think with that in terms of this particular practice. Now, Caitlin, I've just met this afternoon, which is fantastic. So it's a way for us all to meet new people, so I'm frantically getting to my principal pages of notes. But an important part of this project, as we've seen in a moment, is how we can think as academics with others outside of the academic community, and especially with the Indigenous projects with people who work in the community, theatre community. So Caitlin is the company manager and creative producer at La Mama Theatre here at Carlton. And she's also been incredibly instrumental in thinking about community and education in forms of drama and performance. And last but not least is Jennifer Balint, who also works in the Criminology Department here at Melbourne. And her particular focus is on state crime and genocide and how we might think about justice and injustice through those lenses. And we've got a very special addition who's hiding in the back row, which is the Emerita Professor Pat Grimshaw, who has joined us today. And she's said she has nothing to say yet, but she might contribute later. Pat has been an instrumental person bringing and holding together this group of people in terms of showing us leadership for a very long time and how to think with the experience of settler colonial states and the responsibilities of. Missionaries and settler colonists in that process. So thank you for coming. Okay, without further ado, the Minutes of Evidence project is, as I said, comes out of an event and practice of law. For those of you who are not familiar with the history of law in Victoria, we have the infamous honour of being one of the first settler colonial states to introduce fundamentally apartheid legislation. From the late 19th century, the Aboriginal Protection Act, a series of them both created criteria under law for the removal of Indigenous people from place and to put them into basically to quarantine from the rest of settler colonial life, in particular questions of settler colonial practice. In the 1886 Act, the creation of corandu as a mission where people were placed in forms of different kinds of regulations under law about how they could conduct their lives. The practices and conditions of living there under another's law have precipitated the events by which the 1881 Minutes of Evidence Project takes its form. So I think that's probably a useful place for me to stop talking and to hand over to Julie, because what might be useful for everybody here is to see how this project, for many people thinking about research and the academy, it's like we think, well, this is a case study through which we can examine other things, but this has never been only that, has other dimensions. Do you want to describe everybody?
Yeah, sure. Firstly, thank you, Rose and Anne, for inviting us to speak, and thank you all for coming. It's terrific to see you all here. I'm just going to have a few reflections on how we conceptualised the project, what were some of the kind of animating principles behind it. And I think the key one that encapsulates a whole range of things is what are the possibilities for attending to place in academic life? So that's the kind of overarching question that we're going to be addressing over the next few minutes. So as scholars from a whole range of different disciplines, to what extent do we acknowledge, account for, engage with, and seek to ameliorate the structural and historical injustices that have shaped and continue to shape conditions of life in our own backyard? So not just in Australia, I mean, but locally here in Victoria and here in Melbourne. So how do we conduct ourselves as academics in Victoria, where all of us, Indigenous and non-Indigenous people, continue to live with settler colonialism? Indeed, what do we actually know about the particularities of our shared past as Indigenous and non-Indigenous peoples here in Victoria? For all the importance of understanding settler colonialism theoretically, and that's largely how I've spent my academic life as a historian, thinking about settler colonialism as a relatively abstract concept. What are the commonalities and distinctives of how settler colonial poverties have developed in different places and times. In terms of that theoretical engagement, that's one aspect, a really important aspect. But how can we as scholars also move beyond relatively abstract engagements with structural injustice, both here and abroad? How might we establish meeting points that foster collaborative and interpersonal relationships between Indigenous and non-Indigenous people that have the capacity to bring a whole range of shared and distinctive experiences, understandings, knowledges, and laws to bear on the question of how to live together justly in settler societies? How can we pursue possibilities for living together justly in settler societies within a framework that seeks to expand the field of engagement beyond the academy, to foster relationships with government, with community organisations, with Indigenous communities and organisations, and within a process that is deliberately personal, relational and individual? How do we engage also the broader public in conversations about complex concepts such as structural justice? Not just in terms of its application to Victoria and Australia, but also to other instances of mass harm across a range of times and places. And how do we make academic talk about the complexity of the past, the complexity of the relationship between the past and the present, more accessible to a wider audience? How do we bring the past, the present, and the future into meaningful relation? Can expanding the field of engagement through interdisciplinary, cross-sectoral, and interpersonal collaboration enhance possibilities for a lawful future through facilitating the acceptance of political responsibility for the past in the present? So they were the kind of bigger conceptual questions that we were asking and that have framed the formulation of the Minutes of Evidence project. We're happy to expand these as we talk individually and Anne will pose some questions about these things. But just so that you can see what was the thinking behind this project, the website Jennifer will go through in a little while. But just to talk about the project. The project, as you can see here, is called the Minutes of Evidence Project. Minutes of Evidence refers literally to the minutes of evidence of the 1881 inquiry into conditions at the Corindoke Aboriginal Reserve. For those of you who don't know, Corindoke, just outside of Melbourne near Hillsville here, one of the reserves that was established by the government, as Anne was saying, when Aboriginal people were dispossessed in Victoria. As some of you might know, dispossession unfolds very rapidly in Victoria. It's a very swift and intense process. Within a couple of decades, people moved off their lands and onto reserves. Corindoke was the one that was nearest Melbourne. People who established Corindoke were very keen to establish a stake in the land, very much aware of what their political obligations and possibilities were, given the overwhelming evidence that settler colonialism was here to stay. And so on the back of a lot of lobbying, a lot of political engagement with leaders, political leaders from the settler colonial institutions in Victoria, an inquiry was eventually established into Corindoke. There'd been a lot of activism there, a lot of protest, and together with some collaboration from key people in the settler community, the government finally agreed to have an inquiry into what was going on there. So the inquiry, known as the 1881 inquiry, was unique in a number of ways. There were 69 witnesses called. 22 of those witnesses were Aboriginal people, Aboriginal men, women and children. So this is really unique. For those of you who know anything about British colonialism, the 19th century was the year of the public inquiry. There were endless commissions and inquiries all over the place. Very few of them had Indigenous peoples at all as witnesses. If they did, there might have been one or two, and sometimes carefully chosen. Corindoke had 22 witnesses. So it is a unique resource for historians and for us, various scholarly identities in this project, because it is a record for us, a repository of what it was that Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal people had to say about what was going on at Corindoke, and by extension, what was going on throughout Victoria and Australia in terms of the impacts of settler colonialism. So the inquiry is very much distinctive from that point of view. We have access to those voices. It's also distinctive because it gives such evidence of the widespread impact of settler colonialism, but also instances of collaboration around issues of justice, particularly structural justice, between Indigenous and non-Indigenous peoples. And some of the key voices from the settler side of the equation in the inquiry, and whose testimony is most potent, comes from key collaborators, Anne Bonn in particular, and John Green, both people who were very much involved with Aboriginal people around Corindoke. and had a lot to say to those commissioners about what was unfolding in Victoria and what needed to be done. So for us, interested in collaboration, interested in collaborative approaches, here again was something distinctive about the 1881 inquiry that could serve as a model for us, a model for collaboration, both in terms of how we might do this project, but also going forward for how to live together with justly and settler societies. And also a way of contesting those kinds of dominant understandings of the past where it was all settlers on one side, Indigenous peoples on the other, as though there were no common questions being asked about what was unfolding at the time in Victoria. One of the key things that we try and convey in the project is the complexity of the past. I think as historians, we, Pat and I, particularly here and Anne, have a very profound understanding, an immediate understanding of how complex the past is at the time. And so trying to capture the present in the past is something that we're very keen to establish throughout the project. We would never in the present, all of us in the present, dream of trying to characterise the present in the simplistic ways that we tend to characterise the past. And so one of the key things animating the project is to bring the present of the past fully into the picture. The other aspect of the inquiry that is helpful for us in achieving our conceptual goals is the intensely personal nature of the experiences that are conveyed throughout the testimonies. So they are at once intensely personal, but also overtly political. And that is really powerful for us. What this does is make the inquiry have the capacity to talk not only to our immediate interests in terms of our various roles as scholars, but to the broader goals of the project. The inquiry into Corindon doesn't just tell its own story, it tells the story of what was unfolding in Victoria, what was unfolding more broadly in Australia, and what was unfolding in the British Empire, and therefore by extension a whole range of other places in the world. So it has a lot to carry, the Corindon story. I think I might just stop there before I hand over to Jennifer to take us through the website, but just to identify the role of the 1881 inquiry, its immersion in law. The fact that the minutes of evidence are key, that's the key part for us, and how that has acted as a focal point for all of the other dimensions of the project. I'll hand over to Jennifer.
Jennifer, you can particularly explain for those who haven't seen the performance or seen the website exactly how the components are used as well.
What I'll do is show you our website, which has very much been a collaborative effort, which is at the core of the project. So all 13 partners collaborated on the website and sort of went through a number of drafts, a number of iterations, and it also the website was always a very important aspect of the project because it was always going to be the legacy of this project. And in both encapsulating what we're working on right now, but also once the project formally ends next year, then this will also be, and it should be accessible. So there are a number of issues that we're working with here, but it's been very much sort of a way to promote the project, be another meeting point for conversations around structural justice and injustice, as well as provide a legacy for the project. So there are a number of arms of the project, as Julie has noted. So there are four sort of key aspects to it, and they're all here. So if I just go through, we might just start to show you who has actually been involved in the project, so it's probably an important place to start. And so we have our key partners up there. We have a number of Victoria-based partners, Vic Health, Department of Education, Early Childhood Development, University of Melbourne, Arts Victoria, the State Government of Victoria, Gilbidgery Theatre Company, La Mama, Koori Heritage Trust, Victoria Aboriginal Education Association, the State Library of Victoria, Regional Arts Victoria, Deakin University, University of Sussex and Royal Holloway. So it's been a very large collaborative project. We have as I said, the project has a number of key outcomes, which we have here listed. We have sort of on the key outcomes, which we note on the website, towards creating an ongoing legacy of the project, which are research, training and publications about structural justice and injustice, understanding the relationship between the colonial past and the present, how that can inform just futures, and key research training for early career Indigenous scholars, of which Lilly Brown is one. We have three early career Indigenous scholars on the project. Education, so the development of curriculum and teaching resources for secondary schools and advisory protocols for implementing the curriculum. The Vate and Theatre performances of the 1881 Parliamentary Corindoke Inquiry to bring the key justice themes before a broad audience and create these further meeting points, and to establish and develop a model of Indigenous and non-Indigenous collaboration and public engagement. So our key outcomes there. So we, as you can see through the website, we have sort of four aspects outlined there. Research being to focus and extend a conception of structural justice and structural injustice, as it said, on the project. So let's go to the research page. So our key question being that why is it that in so many places there is oppression continuing despite efforts at reform? And this question of enduring structural injustice and how we might actually conceptualise a new structural justice is at the heart of our research on this project. Education, establishing new curriculum in conjunction with Department of Education Early Training, new curriculum for year 9 and 10, history and civics and citizenship students in Victorian schools for the new national curriculum. Been very much about focusing then on the Royal Commission findings of the need to educate the broader population about Aboriginal history and the need to redress the full range of entrenched disadvantages arising from that history if widespread and long-term change is to take place. Performance as another key aspect, clearly. The verbatim theatre production, which we'll be talking more about, and Caitlin from Ramana will be talking about their involvement in that. Hip Corindoke, who will show the country, being verbatim theatre performance, which actually takes the actual words from the minutes of evidence, as well as drawing on petitions, letters, and newspaper articles dated from the time to create a verbatim theatre performance. And there have been a number of performances of this, and there will be continuing next year. And engagement. The Minutes of Evidence project being built on model of engagement and collaboration between university scholars, government and community organisations, Indigenous community members and performing arts, and creating meeting points. And we'll talk more about that, about the importance of creating meeting points, as with the Corindoke Inquiry, as Julie spoke about, being sort of at the heart of everything we do and extrapolating from that. So there are a number of layers to this website, and certainly go to it afterwards. You've all got your bookmarks there that you can take away with you and use. But we have designed the website very much about being a further meeting point and a further meeting point for these conversations.
When we look at the, every time I look at the website, both you know for teaching as well, and through ongoing conversation with all of you, it's just a reminder of how many people are involved in this project, how many different forms of partnership, and just this central idea that you all bring a core commitment to notions of change through this particular collaboration is extraordinary. So it would be, I think, really useful to think about how you all, because obviously you share that as a commitment, and you also share a commitment to want to work with other people in the different work that you've done individually. So how was it that you all came together? Because I'm sure lots of people here who work in interdisciplinary projects feel that sometimes these things happen on an ad hoc basis. How do you draw those interests together? So nice and interesting to think about how, describe how you particularly become involved and might open that up to everybody.
Yeah, so I particularly became involved because Julie asked me, which is
probably that's why these things happen.
Yeah, it was this kind of evolving process. I think it originally kind of started with one of Julie's PhD students speaking to her about these minutes of inquiry that he had found, and he, and this is Giordano Nanni, who was the senior associate on our project, and he thought that this particular episode of Victorian history would be really well known, and when he found these archives and kind of spoke to Julie about them in those terms, and I think it was you that told him actually this wasn't a very well-known kind of episode of Victorian history, and so that's where the initial spark was, and then through that it was really Julie in collaboration with Diotto and then Jennifer kind of building this collaboration around that, and then I came on when I came to Melbourne Uni, and Julie heard me speak about my PhD research, which had been on the Rwandan genocide, but she saw kind of similar issues to what you had all been speaking about in that project, and so it was that process of kind of bringing different people along in that sense. And we can talk a little bit more about how we came to each of the partners as well. In terms of kind of why I was particularly interested in the project, my work centres around how we conceptualise the significance of people's suffering and in turn how we can respond to it based on how we conceptualise and appreciate it. So I was particularly interested in this project that's focused on new ways of engaging with structural and historical injustice. And I guess from a kind of disciplinary background, that stems from a criminological focus on what harm can be seen and appreciated and addressed in society, but also what harm remains hidden from view. And I think structural and historical injustice, and particularly the structural and historical injustice of colonialism, is one of those forms of harm that is incredibly devastating. It's got a real structuring effect on society and people's lives, and yet it's really hard to make it kind of tangible, appreciable, concrete, and visible. And so I was really interested in this project that sought to use different mediums to think about how we could make structural injustice appreciable. And so one medium is clearly performance, which is really exciting and gives you a very different connection with those experiences of the past than if I was to stand up and talk to you about them today. But also, really importantly, I think academic collaboration. And while we talk about this project as interdisciplinary, in fact, I think Mark's kind of kept pushing us to see that it's not really as much interdisciplinary as trying to create something new. So while we talk about our different kind of disciplinary background, it's also all of us bringing that to a kind of common problem and then seeing the kind of new way that can come out of that.
That's great. So I was just going to actually bring Mark in. Sorry, as somebody who joined the project later, if you wanted to sort of describe your the process of your involvement, but also what it, as I mean, there are many people in this project who are trained as lawyers, but are working and in other disciplines and are working outside of law schools to bring this together. But you are one of the few who are not. You're sitting here at the law school. So what did that also mean?
It meant I was going to get a track record with the ARC. it came on because I didn't start here at law school until 2011. And pretty much after that, my first contact was Julie came and asked if I'd be interested in joining the project. I'd been out of the country, so I had no real understanding of what was going on within the project, yet I was very familiar as a public lawyer with how Victoria places itself in the public governing arrangements of Australia, especially leading up to Federation, and the effect of Victoria's leadership and then lack of leadership over how Aboriginal people were placed in law as not being part of the governing apparatus. The governing apparatus was directed at Aboriginal people. So from that, and then it was just, as you alluded to earlier, and it was the personal stuff. I mean, I consider these people now some of my best friends in the trust that was brought about because we were enlivening people's personal experiences. There was a desire to participate in this, not just academically. I think there was reflections of how we were seeing ourselves as individuals, not just as scholars, but certainly looking at this area makes you conscious of what you don't know, or similarly, it makes you very conscious of what you hope you might be able to do with something like this. And so I think that's the reason that I maintain such enthusiasm for not just this project, but it's the concept of bringing the past into the present, not to make sense of it for its historic reasons, but the reason that that my nan used to keep talking about was the law should be a place of hope. And so what is when we actually talk about structural justice, we've still got our own laws. When Ben says the place of hope of law, it's not about blackfellas, it's about white law and how it sees itself, not our place in it, but how it makes sense of itself with respect to us. So, and that hope hasn't diminished because of this project. I think my hope of the law has been certainly elevated because of participation in this project, because the past, and knowing the past now, provides legal ways of understanding an opportunity for the future. So that's my excitement.
Well, another thing I want to draw out at this stage is that one of the key things in this project that does make it special is not just the collaboration between you as people, what that means and what you take out of it as a form of practice for the rest of us to watch, but the communication outside the academy. And I'd like to ask particularly about this, because this is the first time that La Mama was involved in a project like this, and you're always collaborating. The performance is always a joint production. So is this a new thing for the moment?
On this scale?
Yes.
Absolutely. Yes, this is the biggest scale project, multifaceted project La Mama has, as far as I understand, ever been involved in. And I think we were invited in because somebody saw the potential for the theatre. And we're local and we have a history and reputation of telling important stories, often untold stories, and stories of people who might not have had a voice otherwise. I'm totally speculating. I don't know what conversations took place before the door knocked, but so we were invited into the project on those grounds. I wasn't directly involved in those conversations, and then I came in kind of a couple of years in and read the script and saw it all and thought how perfect it was for La Mama. And how perfect it was for theatre, and got really excited about the possibilities to work with academic partners in terms of thinking more deeply about what capacity what we have has. We haven't had that kind of experience before. And working with education and seeing how, you know, all these Victorian students could be affected by this. So it was the first meeting I went to, I kind of ran away going really excited about the million opportunities for every Victorian student in this year to see a production. And obviously I believe very deeply in the way theatre can change your views of things and really move you on an emotional level, which I think in turn makes you think more deeply about things, and I believe in the space of theatre to really allow you to reflect and see yourself as well as society. And I think that's a really powerful medium, and the power of the minutes of evidence was just amazing. It just seemed so urgent. It still seems so urgent for me.
I mean, I was lucky enough to see the first production in a courthouse.
Yeah.
And which, you know, in that particular space, the whole thing about the space in which the and how that changes. So I've seen it twice now, so that initial thing in that tiny space of law was incredibly powerful. And then also sort of bounced out BMW Edge. And again, just to be able to sit inside and outside of you sitting there on the hour, it's a very kind of moving experience. But the first time we went, we took students, I had a class, and we all went. So the education benefits, the pedagogical benefits of we'll be sitting around in class at the Melbourne Law School or in Victorian secondary school saying, these are important questions and history matters, but actually hear language and have that emotional experience was incredibly important. So Lilly, I'll just ask, hear about your, because as a, you know, some of the particular focus on education as a form of community engagement as well. So how your involvement came about and how you worked with this in your projects?
I think unlike you, and you actually got to go see the production in a theatre or in a courthouse, Julie actually contacted me when I was completing my master's thesis overseas, and she said, Lily, would you be interested in the project? And I said yes. So she sent me a DVD of the production, which I watched in my pyjamas in the cold in Cambridge. And I thought, what an amazing project. So I did a little bit of research, and I'd been quite familiar with, I guess, the story of Corinda previously. I was quite aware of that history, quite in awe as well of William Burrock and the kind of struggles that had occurred, and the activism that was really apparent during that time. So I'd gained quite a lot of inspiration for that throughout my undergraduate degree and my honours. So when I did my research and I realised there was this intersection between education, academia and theatre, I thought it was extremely exciting. So education, of course, in terms of formally, the opportunity to be teaching these kind of things in school, but also informally for the wider community in terms of creating awareness. So when I returned back, that's when I met up with Julie, and things started snowballing from there. I've actually started quite late in the project, because a lot of the work that I'm doing is in collaboration with Social Education Victoria, who's in the process right now of creating a teacher resource package and set of protocols for teachers to engage with in school when they're teaching this content to Year 9 and 10 civics and history and social studies classrooms. I'm hoping by the end of my project to have interviewed about 50 teachers about their experience in teaching content related to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, shared history, content and methods. I've done a few interviews so far, and quite overwhelmingly, teachers are extremely excited about the possibility of engaging with this content in their classrooms, because most teachers are teaching or relating to resources which have been created in Western Australia. So a lot of their teaching resources might be like Deliana, which is literature that comes from the other side of the country. There's a huge lack of resources for Victorian teachers to be employing that relates to the history and shared history of this place.
So this obviously underlying all of this is not just collaboration between all of you, but you know, you're collaborating with teachers and also with community. Like, I suppose, Jennifer, do you want to explain how the multiple list of collaborators in this project came together and some of, you know, yeah, how some of the implications of that, like what was it like to conceive of something between all of you and get very excited about it, sense possibilities, and then go, I have to fill in an ARC form and deal with Department of Justice and all these other sorts of partners, how that kind of works.
Well, I can start talking about, I think Julia should probably talk about that sort of early stage, because it was really driven by Julie in that very early stage, you know, bringing us all on board
So it is, how do you translate these broader concepts into something that would be funded, basically? Because theatre is really expensive to put on. We started out with the possibility of having a verbatim theatre performance, but we needed to work out how to fund it. So that meant we had to go down the linkage road, and it meant that we had to get partners who were willing to put in cash in order for the government, obviously, to make their contribution. So we had that kind of pragmatic element, how do you make these broader concepts a reality? And that pragmatic element of getting the funding was what initially provided some kind of framework that we had to work within. Having established those parameters, though, we wanted to get together a team. How do you get together a collaborative team that has the capacity to meet all of these sort of aspirations, who are interested in these aspirations? So firstly, it was the search, obviously, for scholars who were interested, and hence my approach to Jennifer and Di Otto from Law and Nason, people who were within my kind of immediate purview. A lot of this came from my shift from history. I used to work in history here and shifted to criminology. That was really a shift from history to the social sciences for me, and a kind of understanding of what it meant for social science to engage so much more in collaborative work than I had ever done before in history. So it sort of gave me a whole lot more ideas about the possibilities for collaboration and for working outside the academy. And through that, I got to know Jennifer's work and her work around transitional justice. It was a new term for me. I hadn't really understood so much about this kind of formal process for how can governments move from a point of mass harm to a point of so-called justice, and this idea that structural justice, transitional justice might be a process that had a kind of formal capacity, and why we hadn't really undertaken that kind of process in relation to Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal relationships in Australia. So that got me thinking about possibilities for bringing together an interdisciplinary team. So that meant, first in approaching the scholars here and other places that I knew, bringing on people in the community who would be relevant. So certainly La Mama was one of the first organisations Jordana Nani and I contacted, because they had the possibility and the skill to translate the minutes of evidence, which are sort of just pages and pages of evidence, into a verbatim theatre performance. And it was through La Mama who said, you should also speak with Ilbijiri Theatre Company. So the local theatre company in North Melbourne here. We spoke then with Rachel Mazza from Ilbijiri, had further ideas about possibly getting this collaboration on the way, how we could speak with descendants from Corindu, people in community around Corindu, also broader Indigenous communities in Melbourne. So from there we went to the Koree Heritage Trust, who was obviously a body that was able to help us make those contacts. We spent 2 years doing all of this planning, talking with people at Corindu, Barney John Murphy and others, who accordingly then introduced us to a range of other people that we should speak with, Wurundjeri Land Council in Melbourne, speaking to Victorian Aboriginal Education Association Incorporated, AI, speaking before their board, presenting the ideas, presenting the possibilities. Soon became apparent that it was actually quite difficult to understand what we were aiming to do without a model of this performance. So we had to get some seed funding, ask La Mama to help us get a kind of a model of this performance, a pilot going, so we could take it to community, so they could see what it was, so they could see the possibilities and say, yes, go ahead, no, we don't have a bar of it. So following that, we had performances on country in Hillsville that were fabulous, really wonderfully attended. People were very moved by those performances. We had a lot of valuable feedback from people about the nature of the performance might be improved. Incredible kind of stories about people making connections through seeing that performance, connections with family, etc. Through all of these 2 years, we sort of formalised what the possibilities could be in terms of outcomes, and that's how we decided that education, engagement, research and performance would be our four key dimensions, that performance would be a focal point through which the broader stories and the broader goals of the project might be achieved, through which we could speak to a broader range of community, make complex ideas accessible. Through education, we thought this is a way of making the project last beyond its formal period of funding, so that you establish a legacy for the project, you provide a way for teachers in schools to talk about complex material in an accessible way, focused locally in Victoria, as Lilly said. It's not about what happened elsewhere in Australia so much as what happened here in Victoria. And how do you tell that in a way that is hopeful as well as one that recognises the full import of what was going on and unfolding in that period? So how can we make collaboration a way of connecting the past, present and the future possibilities in our artist Marion Young's term? How do you accept political responsibility for what happened in the past in order to make a more just future? So rather than getting stuck within the old kind of dichotomies of the history wars, which become so stifling, you're left with is to either deny the past or condemn it. I think this notion of political responsibility that Iris Marion Young puts forward says, well, you have to know about what happened in the past, but rather getting bogged down in this kind of stifling dichotomy, let's move to a point where we can accept political responsibility in the present on the basis of knowing about what happened in the past, and then decide, well, where do we go collectively, collaboratively from here in order to establish a just future? So through all of that, thinking about education, we clearly needed to be bring on board the Department of Education. They, as you might know, are in a formal relationship with AI. This is part of the outcomes of the Royal Commission into Aboriginal Deaths in Custody. Victoria is one of the few jurisdictions that's taken on that aspect of those recommendations in the Royal Commission in establishing formal relationships between the state and Aboriginal communities. Largely that happens, or particularly that happens through the Department of Justice and all of the regional Aboriginal justice agreements. We're now in the third iteration of that. But also through education. So the Department of Education has a formal association with AI and in anything to do with Indigenous education, both of those organisations are involved. So once we had DECD and AI on board, we thought then about how that legacy might unfold through developing units and teaching resources for the new national curriculum in history and civics and citizenship. Lily's role in this is to see how to support teachers and actually, how do you teach this material? It's not just in terms of content, but how do you deal with your own anxieties about teaching this material? How do you actually operate in the classroom when you're not really sure perhaps about content, but more about what are the issues at stake, and how do you deal with things. So it's really important information that Lily's bringing forth for us. In terms of the performance, we also wanted to make sure that the performance remained a verbatim performance, that it was true to the history at the time, to the voices at the time, and that we could have a production that was accessible to people, that people found moving, that they would then be able to follow up, to sort of explore the meanings in their own way. So for each of those performances, we would have a Q&A at the end. The actors would be on stage, the academics would be on stage, the people who made the performance, producers, etc., on stage, historians. So the audience, if they had a question, they could ask immediately after the performance. And those questions were commonly, well, what happened next? Well, that Edward Kerr who's giving testimony, is that the same Edward Kerr whose book Justice Olney relied on all of those years later in the Yorty Order decision? Okay, this is structural justice. So the audience, structural injustice, this is the audience making that connection through having seen the play. So educational research, I think we've spoken a bit about research, but the concept of structural justice has come together through the research, and now Mark, Jennifer Nason and I are writing a book which is really teasing out what we mean by structural justice and what that might mean. The fourth dimension engagement was really key to the whole project, and it's embedded in the entire project. So, as I said, it took 2 years to get the project together, even to the point of putting in an application to the AIC. So engagement was obviously really important around the telling of the story, around the collaborative telling of the story, and around how it might play out in these other dimensions in the project. Just the final point about engagement. Through the education, we've embedded engagement in that whole process. So the Department of Education over this past year, through Social Education Victoria, has been compiling this curriculum. It's been in consultation with teachers in schools. It's been in consultation with Aboriginal communities all over the place. It's been trialled in a number of schools in the first semester and is being retrialled in a number of schools in the second semester, and really is very much involved in that process. Every time the curriculum is taught, it might initially focus around the Corindoke story, but if it's taught obviously in the Western District somewhere, there will be a version of the Corindoke story that is unique to that place, which will unfold there. And so every time that curriculum is taught in a region like that, it would activate again local links that are already established between that high school and local Indigenous communities. And therefore that kind of engagement is embedded as long as this curriculum would be taught.
I just wanted to say two things about that, because I mean, I've been obviously lucky enough to be following this story as it's unfolded over the project, but just to get a sense of, you know, Julie says that, and it is an incredible achievement, but how difficult that has been, you know, for those of us who just trying to write a normal ARC grant just with ourselves or with three people, to deal with that many partners is an incredible achievement, because you have to translate. So it's the thing about speaking and translating between not only disciplines, but between different forms of performance and engagement is really exceptional. So that, as I said before, that, you know, the project's not only doing something to show by its doing, so, you know, it is a form of education. So on that point, Jennifer, do you want to speak a little bit about what the collaboration has meant, you know, personally for you, and do you think your practices and something we could ask everybody to address as for your disciplinary training and from where you came, from the questions you wanted to think with, might have changed or not changed through this particular engagement?
Look, it's been an amazing project, I think, particularly because of the collaboration, both the collaboration, the academic collaboration, and that we're all coming from different disciplinary backgrounds, as well as the collaboration with partners. Because we have most of our really interesting conversations in forums like this, or just when we're having our conversations around the book and so on, about, because we're all coming from our particular disciplines. And so I come from a socio-legal background. And so I what I found really interesting is it's really challenging the primacy of law. So with the kind of work I do, I look at, well, how is law politically and socially situated? And I look at, well, when does law work? When does law steer? I mean, that's a really key question for sociology of law. But when does law constitute a society? When will it have an impact? When will a judgment have an impact? When will a particular inquiry have an impact? What's really interesting about Corindoke is that it was such an extraordinary inquiry in the testimony that provided, and that it was successful, and yet then it was overridden by the the half-caste, political circumstances, the half-caste act and so on, so the station was well enough, even though they were successful in their claims. What has been really interesting there, so what I find interesting as a socio-legal scholar is that the record, what we're doing with that is the record of law, then we're kind of resurrecting that record of law. So through the related field performances, through education, that we're actually kind of a record that was buried can then in a way get resurrected and a kind of new justice process be established. But it's not, it's outside of law. So the conversations, as Julia was talking about with the Q&As, they're equally important to that record of law. So kind of activating the kind of recognition of historical injustice and the creation of a structural justice. How do you establish a structural justice? Well, it has to be situated in society and those processes, those normative orders, as much as anything that law can do. So it's that decentering of law which has been really interesting and challenging to me, because all of my work has been very much in focus on. And the other issue, which Nathan and I were talking about just before, was, so we, you know, come from backgrounds, criminology backgrounds, looking at historical injustice, transitional justice. When we look at the past, we look at it as, you know, the past as harm, the past as injustice. Whereas I think what Mark and Julie have been really focusing on, which is really exciting, is, well, the past being the promise of justice and the past kind of showing what might be possible. So the past as collaborations, and looking at the collaboration, say, between Barak and Ambon, extraordinary. You wouldn't have got that inquiry if you didn't have that collaboration. Or the way in which the structure of that inquiry allowed for the inclusion of Aboriginal witnesses. So all of these, you know, this is what we need to look at if we are going to look at some form of justice in the present. So it isn't just the part, I mean, the inquiry, the debate and theatre production shows us through using the inquiry and the particular injustices of the time, the particular structural injustices, the particular modes of governance and so on, but it also shows us that collaboration, which has been, I just was thinking about that this morning, actually that's one thing that's been really interesting for me to kind of recognise as equally important, not just saying, oh, look at the injustice, but look at the collaboration. So for, I guess from an academic, you know, that's from kind of some of the challenges to my work and sort of the way my work's engaged, it's been really, very rich process, and that's just, I mean, others know what I talk about, but keep talking about it. How exciting that it's been to work with our partners, you know, and that's just, there's so many layers to collaboration here.
So Mark, don't you want to, obviously you're a great deal of your work is collaborative in many sectors, both politically, jurisprudentially, in your own country, here at Melbourne Law School, to the National Building Projects, you're constantly giving examples of all of us that have worked. So is it, how does this particular project change or influence those practices for you?
It's probably what has come up as a more accurate person and as an academic is it's about trusting people with the ideas that what we all come together for is really that we can have a better future. So trusting the journey that you're about to go on with strangers is probably the way that I go into other kinds of collaboration now, that it's all about the people, not about the people's ideas. And so you've got to build those personal relationships so that you can actually have the trust to have really uncomfortable conversations about why this matters to you. And the other thing for me is talking about structural justice and seeing as a public lawyer where there is a limit to non-Indigenous people talking about their structure, their society, their legal system, in the absence of the exercising of our own jurisprudence and exercising our own jurisdiction when we're talking into something. And it's not just a matter of performance, because I think there's an expectation, and Lilly and I, we it's not that we suffer from it, but there is a responsibility placed on us as Aboriginal people to have a particular way, or a particular way of performing the way that we understand things that makes it understandable to everybody. So this whole project has been, for me, personally about being able to translate what are the limitations of the whole story into a spillover of jurisdiction, because none of this discussion affects my Wiradjuri jurisprudence, or it doesn't affect my or Aboriginal existence, and the two are not the same. We get targeted as Aboriginal people, or we get services delivered to us as Aboriginal people,
yet we have a particular jurisprudence that is not Aboriginal. We might have understandings that are common. So it's placing that understanding back into a discussion with friends and making, you know, I don't want to speak for Lilly, but I am not going to be responsible as an individual Aboriginal person for everybody else's understandings of that time as an Aboriginal person. What I can do, and I think this is where the trust becomes important, is where we have those discussions about the way we were understanding the past for that particular non-Indigenous perspective. But verbatim theatre, to me, is now one of... We had an example of, during the course of this, where performance started to move away from verbatim. And there was a real then sort of dynamic shift in the concept of why verbatim, because it was somebody's voice, it was somebody's language, it was somebody's context. And you cannot put performance and art around that and if you strip it from its context, it then leaves open, or it certainly distorts the opportunities for having a different future if history is distorted in a particular way. And I think that there was such growth. I mean, I got really pissed off with a lot of blackfellas in this over not so much legitimacy of blackfellas, but this was, when going back to what I was saying, this was a public inquiry. It was governmental. It was about citizenship. It was about participation in what we have. And yet there was a particular desire by some people to say that this is an Aboriginal story. And I really had to rally against that. I'm not offended as an Aboriginal person, but it wasn't just an Aboriginal story. Because to make it or to give privilege to the Aboriginal story distorted the relevance of the Indigenous, non-Indigenous relationship at law. And I think that was really something that we had some very brave conversations that resulted in a shitload of drinking to come to grips with the complexity of what we were being asked to do as individuals and collectively. So how do we,
Poor
Caitlin
was
sitting at one of my
rants
one day.
I'm going to
explain the cards.
Okay.
No, I mean, I felt personally, it's all so overwhelming because there's all these levels of conversation and different languages and different priorities and different positions, and everyone's kind of in their little world, and then you'd come together. And so that was really difficult to navigate, as was what is your role in the project. You know, you've got these expertise that some people in the room have, other people don't have. When do you speak up? When do you just hold back? And I suppose what you're saying, it's interesting, because La Mama, I'm a white woman who works at La Mama, and Ilbidjeri Theatre are the Indigenous theatre company. And so that became a problem with conversations because it became an Indigenous story, which, you know, we, I think, all agreed was really a missed opportunity in certain contexts. But as a white woman, I found it really hard to say, that's not how you do that. It's got to be like this, because it was taken away as not, when it really, the point for me was that it was a shared story and that we could come together. So I found that personally and professionally really challenging and really thought-provoking, and, you know, brought really fantastic conversations, often really open conversations and then often quite kind of stifled conversations. And even reflecting on why one conversation was that and not that, it was just like this never-ending kind of, you could just talk and think about it all from all these angles, and then you just read a quarter of someone's paper and go, oh my goodness, there's all that happening as well, and, you know, the logistics, it's just huge. There's so much, which is, the beauty of it. It's just so rich and fantastic. And also the difficulties with it.
So one thing, I mean, we are running to is just
want to ask one more question, we might open up and return at the end just for a response from all of you. But this is our idea of meeting, collaboration is meeting, and that's things that there are people in this room, including Sean McVeigh and Christine Black and others as people as jurisprudents, have been thinking about meeting places, and Lauren and I have been playing around with the idea of encounter between two forms of law and how you think with that in a productive way. But this project does something quite important, in particular to teach many of us how to think with that in our own work, which is about being witnessed. You know, it's like a very literal project to read this evidence as testimony and as a form of witnessing, but in your own practices, what it is, what, you know, the idea of meeting point or meeting place and witnessing means in relation to the project also. So, Lilly, would you like to kind of speak to that a little bit?
I think in the context of education in this project, for me, it was probably one of the first in-depth conversations I had with people outside of education in thinking about future generations and the way that they were going to interpret the past. I think within, you know, often people do work within silos and faculties work within silos, but to have a whole bunch of people from coming from different, a range of different disciplines and backgrounds. So it was a beautiful meeting place of education, academia and research, theatre. And again, that's another reason why I became involved with the project, because I could see these dynamic intersections occurring. And it wasn't just education in schools, and it wasn't just teachers' responsibilities, but it became kind of everyone's responsibility. Everyone that stepped into a theatre to watch the production then kind of had a bit of a responsibility after that fact. So, yeah, really beautiful meeting places and really amazing opportunities, I think about complexity and that idea of structural justice as well, as tricky but amazing because it doesn't actually let you get away with anything. You know, you have to think about the past and the present and then the implications for the future, at the same time as acknowledging that we are in this moment also creating the future in that way. So,
Nathan, did you want to speak on that from the sort of the silo of the criminology and ask?
I'll just say a few words about meeting points. So I guess for me, meeting points were about proximity and fostering that proximity that then kind of creates an ethical relation or creates that sense of need for a response. And so the performance, you know, in that small theatre created that sense of physical proximity, but also I remember Tony Birch speaking in his introduction at one of those first showings of the play about how, you know, these testimonies, kind of picking up that resurrection point, these testimonies that were delivered then, you know, these people couldn't have known that these would be spoken again in this time, in this place, and the power of those actually being re-spoken in that moment. And I think what's important about that proximity is that it forces you to engage with things in new ways and to respond to them. And I think this is something that, you know, I found really helpful talking to Lilly about as well, about kind of making that ethical commitment to be in proximity, even if it's uncomfortable, even if it's difficult, even if it's not clear what you do, even if it is a space of injustice as well that you have to negotiate. And so I think that's what meeting points have meant for me throughout this project and why they're so important to foster.
Anybody else
want
to
I'll just show one scene and then we can have a broader conversation. So I'll just show one of the testimonies from one of the Indigenous Aboriginal witnesses. I'm Alice Grant.
Alice Grant, Aboriginal examined. How old are you?
20.
Where were you born?
Yale.
How long have you been at Cognitive?
Shortly after it commenced.
You are single?
Yes.
What are you doing?
I take the teachings as a monitoress with Mrs. Dean's, and I do the children's washing. I used to do Mrs. Strickland's ironing, but I don't do it now.
When did you do up the ironing?
About 3 weeks ago.
Did you refuse to do it?
Yes. Were you paid wages for doing it? No.
Why did you refuse?
Because I did not want to do it.
Were you told not to do it?
No.
Did Mrs. Strickland ever pay you for any work you did on the station?
No.
How did you get those nice gold earrings?
Mr. Harris, the farm manager, paid me for doing his washing.
You're allowed to do that?
Yes.
You buy those things with the money?
Yes.
I assume that if you were permitted, you'd like to go out and earn money for yourself.
Yes.
You do not believe in working for nothing?
No.
William Barak, Aboriginal, examine.
I might just chip in as well. There was a lot of discussion around the history of verbatim theatre when Giordano was initially translating, not translating so much, but refining the original minutes of evidence into what could be performed in about an hour and a quarter. So inevitably, there's a lot of decisions made. It's not as though you're pretending that everything that is presented is in the order and is exactly everything that was said. Everything that you see in the play was said, but not necessarily in the order in which it unfolded, because obviously you'd be there for 3 months watching the play. We did find that it was really important to talk about that process, though, because one of the criticisms of verbatim theatre is, well, to what extent is it actually exactly what was said, because you're making the claim. So that's where the book came from here. So this is the script, and it also has a background for what the history of Victoria is, but a whole section around how the script was, how the script relates to the original minutes of evidence. So every time there is something that's changed, there's a footnote describing what was changed and why, for example. So it's kind of like a record of how, exactly your question would be, how the minutes of evidence were sort of transformed into something that could be performed in an hour and a quarter. There's other questions that arose, though, as well, around verbatim, and this was around as the performances unfolded. Initially, they were exactly true to Giordano and Andrew James's original script. And then I think the director, Rachel at the time, was keen to have a commentary from the present on the past. So although you're performing the past and the present, there was also a kind of urge to say, well, how can we in the present, as performers or as the director of the play, speak back to that past? So there was an introduction of some ironic clapping like this at certain points when Kerr was speaking, and some laughter off stage, for example, which was really promoting a lot of conversations amongst us. We felt kind of uneasy about that because we think, oh, it's not really verbatim. Nobody was there clapping at the time. Yet you could see the point of view of people saying, well, we also want the capacity to comment on the present and the past. But I think that's a tension around verbatim theatre and kind of the politics of also what was going on. Eventually, when that went on to a little bit further, to more and more theatrical departures from the verbatim script, that it became problematic for us.
But it was also too, the way I understood it when I came on was that verbatim was a way of giving voice to the oppressed, which I automatically had problems with, again, creating the dichotomy or the dilemma that Aboriginal people were always overly oppressed, rather than why couldn't have this been turned around, and the voicing verbatim of the Aboriginal people was to reinvest in their own jurisprudence as speakers, not as a footnote or in record. So it was, and then to actually think about the opportunities for the future of bringing a Aboriginal person's voice into the present, so that there, not just was it about agency and legal agency, there was also the political aspect that I thought was the most intriguing and the most interesting for me, which is it was actually starting to give Aboriginal voices a place of its own for stating it was a talk back. It wasn't talk within. It's we're talking to you about your system. That doesn't affect my Aboriginality and my jurisprudence. It affects yours. And so putting it, making real, so not as just the victim or the somebody who has been placed out as the other, there was actual political agency in saying this is your system and we can talk to it, not being part of it. So verbatim became a really, from an interdisciplinary point of view, something that we could all attract to, because I was attracted to it from the legal point of view and jurisprudence and acting as a jurisprudent.
Can I just ask a question there, because there's obviously a sort of tension between a shared commitment to use verbatim but also to perform verbatim. So the clapping, from the perspective especially from performance, of how to, a performance has to be theatricalised. There has to be kind of, there has to be sound and movement and other kinds of ways of communicating words that are, so is there, I suppose what I'm asking is there a tension between just political commitment and viewpoint and standpoint and approach to the jurisprudence, and also just the technicality of putting on a show, you know, so was that something that...
It was a huge point of contention, I suppose, and I don't believe that a piece of theatre does have to have all the bells and whistles. We operate on a total fringe at La Mama, and we're very much about kind of poor theatre style and doing things, you know, the integrity of the words have real merit, and we don't have many lights and we don't have really anything, and I think we make lots of the best theatre in Melbourne because of that kind of necessity. And I personally was of the view that clapping halfway through a scene actually interferes with the integrity of the moment. The other side of the coin is about engaging young people and kind of making sure, and I personally think that's unfair on young people to think that they need, you know, it's patronising to say that they need something big and grand in order for them to engage with it. I don't believe that's the case. I think they're very intelligent and able to listen to these words that have so much power and meaning. And that's what we're all, that's what we're on about.
There's a question.
Yeah, firstly, I just want to thank you all for sharing what is a hugely inspiring collaborative project. Like, I'm really in awe for the work that you've all done. I guess I'm really interested in the way that you've come up with such a creative way to take a broad spectrum of members of our community on this journey, and a kind of journey that you've really tried to design so that people, that journey doesn't stop after the performance, that it really leaves people with questions and that sort of sense of responsibility looking forward into the future. But with everything that you've shared today, it's really apparent that you've all gone on a really interesting journey in being involved in this project. So I'm just wondering whether or not you've thought about, you know, getting a documentary filmmaker involved or something like that, because it's just, it's so, I was just wondering about that, because I think the process that you've been through is something that we can all learn lots from.
I mean, it's been an extraordinary journey, that's true. And I mean, when I was reflecting before about, you know, where I've come sort of from my own disco perspective, it's also about where I've come as well in terms of, you know, collaborating with theatre, with education, people and so on. This is what can be done, where justice resides, where it needs to reside, where the questions that we need to be asking. Having the minutes of evidence performed, and so including associated petitions and letters, which do form part of the performance at La Mama the very first time, just having, they were reading. This was called a reading. It wasn't, you know, it was amazing. It was so powerful. I remember going to the rehearsal, sitting in and seeing kind of the process, but then also just going to the final, the first performance. I think, Pat, you mentioned that you knew this inquiry back to front as a historian, and going and seeing it for the first time was just so powerful. And the power of theatre, like, we're all sort of devotees of theatre, I guess most of you are, but been to so much theatre in my life, but I'd never sort of recognised its power and how it can promote such a public conversation and promote such an important meeting point. And so at the heart of this project, as we've been talking about, is creating meeting points for discussions around structural justice and injustice and seeing how that can be done. I think that was, it's been extraordinary.
Well, I've been around so long that it wasn't new to me. In 1990, for a few years, I taught a first year subject here at Melbourne on it was an introduction to social history. And we spent one term, as it was then, on this inquiry. And it was just amazing to me to see how students responded to history when it wasn't reading a lot of history books, but it was actually going in and using their own creative imaginations. But history subjects became more streamlined after that, you know, Plato to NATO. There was no more of this trivia. And that was one thing that, you know, attracted me very much to be part of this project, was the sense that somehow history is inevitable. If oppression wins in terms of legislation about Indigenous people in 19th century Victoria, it was as though it was a lay down the zero. And in fact, pausing on so-called trivia to actually look at the interactions around that oppression and the fact that it is resisted and that Aboriginal people resisted it and also humanitarian settlers resisted it with them, gives people now, or gave these students a different sense that there were other possibilities. And you couldn't just say, well, don't blame Kerr, etc., etc. Everyone thought like that then. So how presentist to call them racists? They knew of alternatives. And they decided to ignore them for their own, for reasons the students were not slow in discovering. But it was a different view of legislation and regimes of control about Aborigines they received from what was looked like a bypass in history that you could have left undone. So, you know, Plato to NATO has its part in history, but so too these in-depth studies and both the studies that you all did bringing it into structural justice, etc., in theoretical ways I didn't necessarily follow. But for me, bringing it into a sense of the importance of good history, being known in the present, if actually you want the justice on the ground to proceed, I felt it was the most important possibilities, and I am seeing them, I think, realised. Particularly through the education of secondary school students, which I think is a most important marker of what a society wants to understand about the past, because it's what you're prepared to allow your young to know.
I think Rose wants us to.
Why not?
I don't want you to.
I'm sure the participants on this panel will be happy to stick around for a little time if they can afterwards, in case you have other questions. But just to tackle on Pat's last point, so, which is to say, as a historian, this is what it means to conduct yourself responsibly as a historian in Australia, in Melbourne, thinking about what are the most profound questions that Australian historians should think about, and how the rest of your mind, from your own traditions and disciplinary practices, consider what that might mean to conduct your own methods responsibly as a way to conclude. So, Julie. Add anything, or was Pat
signed in the last? No, I just perhaps elaborate on the point of meeting points, how important they are. And I think people have teased meeting points out perhaps more as middle grounds, and I think middle grounds are kind of places that have been spoken about historically. Richard White's done a lot of work around middle grounds and how at certain points of colonial engagements around the Great Lakes area in North America, different sorts of communities, imperial powers, when they weren't quite prepared to press home the advantage, were prepared to engage with Indigenous peoples. Indigenous peoples were prepared to engage with different sorts of invaders in order to pragmatically come up with kind of different kinds of engagements that were predicated on each other's ways of knowing rather than imposing one particular way of knowing. And I think Paul Carter, in another way, in the Of the South edition of Griffith Law Review that came out of the seminar that was held in 2006 that Sean and others were engaged with, spoke about middle grounds in a similar way, that a way that it's, you need to have these middle grounds if you're going to promote different ways of proceeding in the future, ways that aren't kind of conditioned by one way of knowing, but rather promote something new that can come out of the meeting of the laws. And so middle grounds like this, I think, are really, really important.
Did you
want to
add anything?
I often find it quite frustrating that discussions within universities are often based on a false dichotomy, so between theory and theory and concepts and then practice in the real world. And I know historically for Aboriginal people, what's happened in the university has had a huge impact outside of the university. I think looking at it in that way, and that dichotomy, actually stops us from taking responsibility for the way that we are informing society. And just picking up on what Julie said, for me, being an early career researcher and seeing the way that these guys have practiced in collaboration with one another, I think it's been really representative of a kind of preparation for dialogue in the way that a lot of these guys as my supporters and mentors have worked in that collaboration, which is also only made possible because of the collaboration that happened in the past. So, and obviously this collaboration here in the present will have implications for the future too. So.
I suppose my sum up to this is, how do we actually allow everybody to say the law doesn't and justice doesn't happen out there, it happens in here, and we're all as responsible as individuals into the law. Structural justice is not something that you can talk about, you can actually, that exists out there. It is actually something that we embody, we enliven it as individuals. So that's my quest for life now. Be just, but how do we actually explain to people, because justice is always talked about by lack of responsibility of the individual to something out there.
Just to briefly add, I guess, just to reiterate what Lily said about kind of transcending that division between theory and practice, but also what Julie said about expanding the field of engagement so you get a kind of engaged academia. And I think part of the question for us of conducting ourselves responsibly as academics as well as embodied in our commitment from the very start that this project would have a legacy beyond. So it wasn't, the question was kind of what did we want to do with this project, but then it was like, well, how does it not just have a 3-year life? And that's where education came to be so crucial, and the website came in. And now Lamona is going to be involved in producing a DVD of the performance as well. And so I think that legacy aspect is a really important part of responsibility.
And hopefully re-perform it. As in there will be more productions.
Yeah.
I mean, I would just encourage everyone to do, to take the step and get through the hard work and the negotiations, and I just think it's been such a worthwhile pursuit, and just so wonderful. Do it!
That's right.
And yes, if you haven't seen the performance, it might be an idea to sign up to Lamana's website as well as our website, so we can sort of send out information when that's available. I mean, to keep these conversations going, which is talking about what does it mean to act responsibly, I think it is. This is the kind of work I think that academics need to be doing is too big an ask. We know it's difficult to get the funding. But I think for us it's been a real meeting of that kind of the theory and practice, and like showing like what might be possible, and we're all taking it in different directions. I think after this, and particularly in some of the similar directions about being responsible academics, practitioners, and sort of making continuing to have those conversations and create these points around justice.
Well, I can't thank you all enough, because I'm talking about huge amounts of courage and fortitude and to put this together over such a long period of time.
So much easier when you're drunk.
That's the lesson to take, but it is, as an those of us who do work in this particular space, it is an incredibly fraught space to work in, and it's so important. It cannot be done by yourself. It is about to respect the encounter. You have to be, you've constantly got to work with others, and it must be witnessed, and this does offer us an incredible example. But for those who do not work in this particular space, it also offers a fantastic, to return to Rose's initial provocation for the series, to think with other people to create work that is exceptional and does have impact beyond the silo sitting